thank you and we praise you. And Lord, we just are so thankful for your presence. We thank you, Lord, that your presence is life to us, that it is the air, Lord, that we long for. You are the breath of life, and we just thank you for your presence. We thank you for the increased way that we experience it as we gather together. And Lord, I just commit this to you, Lord. People didn't come to hear me, they came to hear you. So I just commit, Lord, everything that is said unto you, Jesus, and I just ask that you would speak. And Holy Spirit, we just thank you. I ask that you would speak things specifically and uniquely, Lord, to each heart and to each mind. Father, I ask, God, that you would even now just plow the ground of each heart, Lord, to receive, Jesus, the seed of your truth and the seed of your word. And we just thank you, Lord, that your word is powerful, that when it goes forth, it does not return void. And so we just thank you for it. And we just ask all this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right, so we are on 2 Kings 6, and we're starting, just going to read the first 7 verses. All right, here we go. And the sons of the prophets said to Elisha, "See now, the place where we dwell with you is too small for us. Please let us go to the Jordan, and let every man take a beam from there. And let us make a place there where we may dwell." And so he answered, "Go." And then one said, "Please consent to go with your servants." And he answered, "I will go." So he went with them. And when they came to the Jordan, they cut down trees. But as one was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. And he cried out and he said, "Alas, master, for it was borrowed." So the man of God said, "Where did it fall?" And he showed him the place. So he cut off a stick and threw it in there, and he made the iron float. Therefore he said, "Pick it up for yourself." And so he reached out his hand and took it. It's the word of the Lord. So just a little before I go into kind of where I feel like the Lord wants us to go today, just a little context, because I've read this passage before, and you know, when it's talking about the sons of the prophets going to make a place, they're talking about a meeting place. They're not talking about, you know, because I read this in kind of some commentaries. I think I pictured this like communal living where they all live together. But they're saying this place where we have come to gather with you, Elisha, because you are the prophet. You are the one that we're here to listen. People are coming. It's growing. And all of a sudden, this place is too small. So you know what we're going to do? We want to go and we want to build. So everybody's going to take something, and we want to build, and is that all right? And Elisha says, "Go. Go and build." And in the midst of the building, you know, we heard the rest of the story. Somebody's got this borrowed axe. They're all excited. The axe head flies off, and it sinks, and Elisha does a miracle. He throws a stick in, a piece of wood, and as he throws the piece of wood into the place where the axe head fell, the axe head rises to the surface. And he looks at the guy and he says, "Take it. Pick it up and take it." And as I read over this passage, I felt like the Lord said that what we're going to look at today is we're going to just glory in the gospel. We are going to glory, glory, glory in the good news of Jesus, because it's right there. You know, Jesus said when he rose from the dead and he met the disciples along the road to Emmaus, he's talking with them, and you know, they're like, "Where have you been? Don't you realize Jesus has been crucified?" And as he's talking, he's basically, it says that he goes from Moses through the prophets, and he's saying, "I was there, and I was there, and I was there, and I was there, and I was there." So when we look at some of these Old Testament passages, we can look and see, oh, boom, there was Jesus. There's Jesus, there's the gospel. And the thing that I felt like, okay, what is the heart of this story? And this is where we're going to start. Something was lost that was restored. Something was lost that was restored. And we can all look and think about in our own lives, if you are a Christian or a pre-Christian, maybe you have not received the Spirit of God on the inside of you, we can all say things have been lost, something has been lost. And Christ came, and in this story, it says, through the cross of Christ, he restored. So the thing that I felt like the Lord wanted me to highlight in this is we can look at, like, when sin came, there were so many things that were lost. You know, sin, it says the wages of sin are death. It literally, sin produces death. Selfishness and hatred and envy and jealousy and everything that is wrong and all of these things inside of sin. We can see broken, what was lost that the cross restored. But the highlighted thing I felt like the Lord said to me is one of the main things that was lost is that we lost this ability to commune with the Father, spirit to spirit. We were created to commune and have intimacy with the Father in the Spirit. In the Spirit. We are, this phrase, I'll probably say it again, but it really has kind of messed me up in my relationship with the Lord, because sometimes we go to church and we get very head heavy, and we get very, I would almost say, just intellectually minded, but we were created to be people of the Spirit. But the saying is that we are not natural people having a spiritual experience. If you have Christ on the inside of you, we are spiritual people living in a natural world, communing with the Holy Spirit, letting the Spirit of God flow through us. We are made to hear a voice saying, go. You know, I remember, and this is irrelevant, but I thought of it this morning. When we were in Rocky Boy, I remember just there was a lot of spiritual warfare. There was a, I don't know, yeah, ton of spiritual warfare, and things would happen, and they would creep in. I remember reading through the whole thing with when Elisha says that the king, Elisha knew what was going to happen in his bed. And I remember praying. I said, God, would you show me the attacks before they come? And I just felt like, why not? Why not? Lord, show me. I want to be one step ahead. Why don't you reveal to me so I can be in step with you, in spirit with you, that we were made to live in the Spirit. And maybe you don't need this today, but I needed this week. I kind of just felt like the Lord said, Amanda, kind of shaking me. You are living in the Spirit, by the Spirit. And I love that these ladies are, and JD, sorry, and Justin. Huh? And David, sorry. like, got the girl thing happening today. That they sang Multiplied. Because they sang that song, that line, I have surrendered to your design. What was God's original design? Adam and Eve were created, the breath of God, and he walked with them. In the cool of the day, I will surrender to your design to live and to walk and to move in the Spirit. And I'm not saying this that we should all get creepy weird, but I do think that we were made for more than what we're experiencing, that he has more. And just to reawaken that we are spiritual beings because God is spirit and we are created in his image, spirit. We possess a soul, and we live in this temporary body because someday this is going to pass away, and the true part of us is what's going to remain. So what was lost that was restored? The main thing is this beautiful communion with the Lord through the person of the Holy Spirit. And we're just going to look really quick. I just want to look at John 3. I think just kind of revisiting the gospel a little bit. Because the gospel is not just, I pray a prayer to get to heaven. It's not just, not discounting it, but it is not, this is, one thing happens to get me here. The gospel is the restoration of all the things that were lost. It is so many things, and I feel like the Lord has really been talking to me, and even this morning, I'll go there in a second. Let's just look at John 3. I'm just going to read a few verses and just kind of highlight some things, because if you've been a Christian for a while, or if you haven't, or maybe somebody shared the gospel and says, you must be born again, don't always think about what that means. But in John 3, Jesus is talking to a Pharisee. I knew it was Nicodemus. I just couldn't remember exactly what if he was a Pharisee. But we're going to read verse 3. And he said, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom. And the reason I'm highlighting that verse is because there's a note in my Bible where it says again. The other translation, it means from above. Unless someone is born from above by the Spirit, unless the Spirit of God, unless heaven comes back into you, then we will not see the kingdom of God. We must be born again. We must be born again. I love the gospel. I love the good news. Anytime I get away from it is when I find myself in a bad place. I was praying about how to order this message because there were a lot of things I saw in the passage. And I was driving and just kind of praying, and I heard the Holy Spirit. He said, Amanda, start with the gospel. Because anytime you don't start with the gospel, things get messy. Because we are trying to get somewhere where we already have been seated. We are working, we are comparing, and there's just so many things that get messed up. Start with the good news. Start with the good news. So pointing to the cross, what was lost that was restored, kind of going back to the axe head. We're going to, in this conversation, I'm not going to read the whole passage because I kind of thought today this will either be really short or really long or maybe in between. Who knows? But I'm going to try not to go too far here. Later on, Jesus is talking, and he's still talking to Nicodemus, and they're talking about being born again. And they're talking through this, and this is what Jesus says in verse 14. Actually, we're going, verse 14. And he said, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up. There's the cross. The Son of Man must be lifted up on the cross, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. I'm not going to stay here too long, but I just wanted to highlight that eternal life, we will go to heaven someday. If you've asked the Lord to be the Lord of your life and the Spirit of God to live inside of you, there is a timeline destination. But eternal life also, I just want to read what this means. This was in a commentary. It says, eternal life is not just talking about duration of time. It is not just a linear thing that we will live forever. Believers live in eternal life right now. Experiencing the quality of God's life as a present possession. Eternal life is living and residing on the inside of you if you believe in Jesus. God's life, the quality of the God kind of life through the Spirit of God. That's powerful. You ever wake up in the morning just being like, holy cow. I was going to say crap. Not that it matters. I just didn't know if anybody would be like, wow, look at you. The God who breathed the stars in the universe, his Spirit resides on the inside of me. Eternal life is working in me right now. So what did he come to restore? Eternal life. The spirit-to-spirit communication that we have with the Lord. We were made for this. It is our natural habitat. Spiritual living and spirit-to-spirit communication is our natural habitat. Anything outside of that is like a fish outside of water. We are struggling for breath. It is our natural habitat. This is what we were made for. This is what he restored us to. So I want to read this really quick. We're going to go to 1 Corinthians 1:18. Because as I've been preparing this, I'm looking at this and I'm like, okay, we're going to talk about the gospel. And over the last 2 days, I keep hearing this, like, I just know it's the enemy, but like, it's too simple. They know that. People know that. This is just oversimplified. Come on, Amanda. They know that. Simple, simple. And this morning as I was praying, the Lord brought this scripture to me and I want to read it. It's in 1 Corinthians 1:18. So good. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. Seems foolish, but it is. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The message of the cross is the power of God. And it just goes on to say that basically the wisdom of God is greater than anything else, and it looks foolish, but the cross is the power of God. And inside of it is everything we're longing for. Gosh, I'm like... carried away. Anyway, And I just felt like today I just wanted to emphasize too, you know, sometimes to meditate on the gospel, a good question is, Lord, to ask questions. What else have you restored me to? What does that look like now? I think sometimes we stop and there's some questions that, what is that? And how do I move forward? And can you show me some more and what that looks like? Expand to me what this is. Okay. First thing is something restored that was lost. Second thing in that passage was when he lost, because we're working our way backwards. This is kind of odd, but we're actually taking the story and we're working our way backwards because we're starting with the gospel and then we're going to go to how we kind of walk this out. The second thing, there was a debt that the man who lost the axe head could not pay. Most commentaries, when he cried out, alas, it was borrowed. He is stressed. He's like, dude, I just lost an axe head. I cannot repay this. Like, it wasn't just like, oh, my precious axe head. It's that, wait a minute, I borrowed this thing, and I don't think I can pay it back. So going back to the gospel, so Elisha's like, got you. All right, you can't pay for this. I got you. Takes the wood, throws it in the water. The cross is the only thing that can pay for what we owe. The cross is the only thing we cannot pay for what we owe. And I want to look at this in Colossians 2. Start in verse 13, and it should all be up on the screen. I'm like sweaty. Sorry. You guys all really needed to know that. So he paid a debt that we could not pay, and I just want to look at this because it is so in the scripture, and I just love the word. Yes, okay. 2:13, this is talking about us, and you and me, being dead in your trespasses, in the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven all your trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. So what that is saying, that scripture, when it says having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, it was in the time what they're referring to when it says the handwriting, it was commonly used when a monetary obligation was acknowledged by a debtor. It was a signed confession of indebtedness, a bond or self-confessed indictment. So here's what it was. Amanda Reed owes $1 million. Boom. There's this thing that right now is written up against me. But how about more to the spiritual aspect? Amanda Reed has sinned. She's been selfish. She lied. She hurt someone. Amanda Reed should pay. It's right here. I have it written down. It is right here what she's done. There is some handwriting that is against me. And there was some handwriting that was against everybody in here. There is not one person that can be like, you know, I'm good. I've done nothing. I've never hurt anybody. Let's be honest. We all probably did something today. You know, we like to struggle on our way to church when everyone's trying to get their best spiritual face on and you're like ready to punch your husband, you know? I mean, it's like, seriously, I cussed out my husband. Nobody in here, nobody. I did this. But that's what it's saying in that verse. It's saying there was handwriting that was against us. And it says on the cross, he take that handwriting and he ripped it up. He wiped it out. And he said, you know what? I'll pay. I know you can't pay back that axe head because it was borrowed. I know you owe, but I will pay. I'll pay for it. And only Jesus can pay for it. Because he's the only one that was without sin. And that's what he came for. He restored our intimacy. He paid the debt that we owe. I mean, seriously, can we really, and this is what I was going to bring up earlier, can we really exhaust the gospel? That we know it? I remember one time I was in Rocky Boy, and we were pastoring there, and I was, it's funny how you have these moments, and you're like with the Lord, and you just remember everything that was happening. I was washing dishes, and I had just read through, I think it was the Gospel of John, and I was thinking about where to go next. And I felt like the Lord said to read it again. And I said, I just read that. He said, oh, did you exhaust it? And I just remember being like, wow, you're right. You're so right. No, I didn't exhaust it. We cannot exhaust the good news and the glory of this gospel because it's so much better than I know. It's so much better than I know. It is now, it is to come, it's so much better than I know. The gospel is such good news. So we couldn't pay for it. But the interesting thing is even though he couldn't pay for it, the miracle happened, the wood was thrown in, and the axe head rose to the surface, the prophet said to him, once it rose to the surface, he said, pick it up yourself. We cannot pay for it, but we do have to pick it up. We do have to take it up. We have to receive it. And I'm not just talking to people that maybe have not been born again. I'm talking to all of us. That we, I want to be careful. I just want to be like, every day. But I feel like for myself, every day I need to pick up the gospel. I believe every day I need to sit and be like, Lord, thank you for your blood that I am so clean because of what you've done. I thank you, Lord, that even though there is a voice of condemnation that is telling me to remember the sin that I committed or telling me to remember that I'm maybe not enough or to compare myself with someone else, I just thank you, Lord, that your blood has made me so righteous and that when you look at me, you are smiling because of what you've done. And I thank you, Lord, that I am new and your spirit lives on the inside of me. And even though I may not hear it right now, it is who I am because I was dead, but I'm alive. So I believe that every day we need to pick up the gospel. And I'm going to look at, there's just a scripture in Psalm 116. I love this. I'm so enthusiastic. I love this. Don't we love the word? It's good. It's so good. It's so much better than we know. It's not boring. It's not dry. It's just because we need the Spirit of God to reveal this to us. We need the Holy Spirit to unearth the goodness and the glory of what he's done. We need the Holy Spirit for that. Psalm 116, and this is what I'm talking about when he says, okay, pick up the axe head. David is saying, he says, what shall I render to the Lord for all of his benefits towards me? I will take up the cup of salvation. This is our what he's drawing. What am I going to give God back? How can I repay what he's done? I'm going to take up this full cup of salvation and I'm going to drink from it. I'm going to receive the cup of salvation. I'm going to receive all that he's done because I cannot earn it. I will not deserve it, but I'm going to take it up and that's how I'm going to honor the gift. Because I'm going to receive the gift with gladness and drink it. I was going to kind of, see, this is going to go shorter, but it's okay. So when I talked about the Spirit of God, I just want to look at a scripture really quick, and I'm kind of backtracking, but I just feel like it's important to look at that we need the Holy Spirit. He's restored us to spiritual things, right? Spiritual intimacy. And I just want to read this verse out of 1 Corinthians 2:10. This is talking about basically like if the enemy would have known what was going to happen, they would have never have crucified Jesus. He would have never have crucified Jesus. And that's why I'm saying we need to look at the goodness of this gospel. What actually happened? What actually happened? Eternal life, but there's a little more that he did. And this is kind of going back to the Spirit of God. We need the Holy Spirit. We need to be spiritual people. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. I don't even know how many verses I gave you, so sorry, I'm reading beyond what I gave them. Sorry, I'm going to read that again. Now we have received, okay. Even though no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God, now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. We need the Holy Spirit to know the things that have been given to us. And it goes on, and I won't read the whole thing, but it says the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit. They can't, because the Holy Spirit is not in them. We need the Holy Spirit to really have this full revelation of what the Lord has done. And in that, kind of taking up the cup of salvation. She might watch this later, so I like to talk about people in my messages, so you should, just kidding, kind of. So I have this friend, and this is kind of talking about taking up the cup of salvation and looking at the wonder of what the Lord has done, and her and her husband just got back from Italy, and they had been saving for years to go to Italy, and like, this is like her dream, so they spent 2 weeks there. But they not only saved to go to Italy, she's like, I saved enough airline points to fly first class on the way over there. So she's telling me about this, and she's like, have you been in first class? I'm like, no. No, thank you for bringing that up. I haven't. you don't get, especially on long flights. If you've ever taken like more than a 10-hour flight and you are in a cramped seat and you walk and like glimpse into first class, you're a little bit like, wow, hate you right now. I hate all that you have. Just kidding. So she's talking about she's in first class, and they have these pods. She's like, it lays down into a full bed. And they bring you this lavender-scented towel, and it's amazing. And she's like, I'm in there, and I'm just like, I'm clapping. I'm like picturing her, and she's like in first class just clapping. She said, and then we get to Italy, and we're set, and it's this house on like a hillside, and there's the ocean, and her and her husband are doing these little hikes, and as she's walking, she's like raising her hands, and she's applauding. She's just like, this is amazing. And as she said that, like, gosh, the Lord just, like, the Spirit leapt in me, and I felt like that is what we need to be doing when we're looking at what he's done, is like, this is amazing. Oh, my gosh, have you seen this? Like, raising her, like, just picturing her on the plane. Great, you know, well done. Well done. Thank you for this first class section. But I just feel like in our relationship with the Lord, he is like, come in, come a little closer, and let's glory and applaud and look at what he's done. Good news. It's good news. I didn't know. When I first got saved, I mean, I was like radically saved, and I was in love with the Lord. And then I started going to church, and I'm not, like, sounded bad. And then I started going to church, and it just all went downhill. It didn't. But I think when I had this encounter with the Lord in my bedroom, this whole spiritual encounter where I was just like, whoa, there's this real spiritual world that is happening. And I think when I heard the gospel, it was like, okay, you're just going to heaven. Not that that's just, but it's okay, pray this so you can stay out of hell. And I didn't know all of the things. And I'm still want to know. I believe for eternity, we're going to be like my friend and be like, well done. Well, like amazed at the things that he has done and that he's doing. And in that scripture, in 1 Corinthians, it talks as eye has not seen, nor ear has not heard what the Lord has in store. And that's when it's saying that the Holy Spirit is the one who reveals it. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. We were made for this. This is our natural habitat. We were made for this. Man, I love him. He's so good. And then, yeah, this is the last thing. Actually, a little bit short but sweet. So we're going to talk a little bit about the last thing that happened in this passage, since we're working our way backwards. So he restored the axe head. You know, he paid the debt. He had to pick it up himself. But really where it began was that they were building something. Really, they were building something, and they were gathering around the presence of Elisha. And what I see is a picture of the church. So what Christ has done, and they're like, man, we need to gather around you because you have the words of life. And it was growing. Like, people saw the things that Elisha was doing, the miracles that were happening, and it was growing. They're like, this place has gotten too small. We can't contain it, so we need to build. And what it says, I just want to highlight this verse. You know, they ask him if they can build, and here's what it says. He's asking, and he says, please, this is verse 2 in 2 Kings 6, please let us go up to the Jordan, and let every man take a beam from there, and let us make there a place where we may dwell. And he answered, go. And this is what I saw, is that everybody carried a beam. Everybody carried something to the building of the house. Everybody carried something to the building of the church. Every man's going to carry something. I was kind of, honestly, full disclosure, I'm like, sometimes I share things and then I'm like, gosh, later on, why? But this isn't that big of a deal. But I was like, this morning, just kind of stressed. I'm like, man, God, I don't even know where you want to go with this. And I'm a little stressed. And what if I forget everything? And I heard him say to me, he said, Amanda, all I need you to do is pick up the beam I've asked you to carry. And you just trust me with it. This is the beam that I've asked you to carry today. In this gathering together, just pick it up and I'll do the rest. So everybody carried something, and we all carry something. Now that we live and have this great salvation, what do we do with it? We all have something that we bring to the building of his global body. Everybody carries something. And everything that is carried is important. So I want to look at 1 Corinthians 12. And this is now if you've received Christ and we are part of a body, in 1 Corinthians 12, it's talking about how there's one body but many members. And each member is distinct. Each member is different. And I just want to read this because I just feel like it's important. So starting in verse 12, I'm going to read the whole to 21, I think. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slave or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. As he pleased, he set them in there. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? And I'm actually just going to stop there. Every member matters. What you carry to the building of God's church, of his kingdom, it matters. You know, as I read this passage and it talks about if the eye is like, well, I'm not a foot, so I don't matter. Or the foot's like, you know what? I really only need one eye. So, or you know what? I really don't need that other leg. You know, working in the hospital and you've seen people that have like amputated parts, I could be stepping out, but I doubt they're like, you know, I don't miss that leg. You know, I mean, seriously, I doubt they're like, life is so much easier now that I don't have that. I'm so glad that I'm missing this part. I just don't think that that's a common thing that's going to happen. And in this passage, they're saying, you know what? Every part is needed. But what I also want to highlight is that here's an interesting verse in the beginning of this. And I feel like this is something I've kind of missed when I've read this passage. I've always kind of read it, you know, all of us in the body are different, but here's something I also feel like Paul in this passage is highlighting. In verse 13, it says, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slave or free, and have all been made to drink in one Spirit. And I think a lot of times we read that and we're like, what does that even mean to me? Jew or Greek, slave or free, yeah, blah, 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 blah. You know, you just like don't really like think about what that means. But what if we were to bring it down to our context, whether Native American or white, Hispanic, female, male, rich, poor. So here's what he's saying, is that, and he says that we've all been made to drink into one spirit. So here's what I see him saying, is that he's kind of highlighting that we look a little bit different. Maybe white or Native American or male or female, but we drink of one spirit. And each part, when we drink of that spirit, we are releasing a distinct part of who the Lord is. And it's saying, do not disqualify yourself or somebody else because they look different than you. And he's saying, here's, because he goes on to say that each part matters. I need your expression of the Lord. I need your expression of the Lord. In different cultures, sometimes people get tripped up. Like, I'm offended by you. We need every culture. Because every culture that is drinking of the Spirit of God is releasing something that is unique. And we need that if we want to see the full expression of Christ. That's what it's saying. There is one Spirit. And even if you're offended that I'm up here because I'm a female, sorry. I mean, not to be like rude, but I just feel like there's something that I bring that's important. And not to be like, I'm great, but I mean, God, that's what it says. And if I don't receive that, then I'm not only missing out for myself, so are you. So are you. And I also feel like to just highlight, there's nothing too small. Sherry, the other day, I love this. She's like, my gift is feeding people. And I'm like, that's so awesome, because it's not mine. You would all starve. And I'm like, I love that she, because that matters. And here's kind of the example I felt like the Lord gave me. So, and totally don't judge me. Friday night, I'm home, and I'm watching the NBA Finals, okay? Because I love basketball. And I just think they're great. So, if you can get a picture of this, I just thought it was kind of fun. Like, so here's how it goes. I want the Celtics to win. They're playing the Golden State Warriors. I'm crazy, okay? I am crazy. Poor Eric, he's watching it with me one night, and I'm like, gosh, you guys are idiots. What are you doing? And I'm like yelling at the TV, and he's like, you don't even know these people. And I'm like, I know. I know. I need to get a grip and get this together. I do. I was thinking, I'm like, I'm not staying home watching the game. It's sermon prep, because now I have an illustration. it's fine. Totally fine. But here's what was stuck out to me. So they're talking. It's the Golden State Warriors and it's the Celtics. Some of you, you're like, blah, blah. I don't even know what you're talking about. But they're talking about Steph Curry. So if you've least heard of Steph Curry, he's like one of the greatest like three-point shooters. And right now, he's the main one that's carrying the team. And these commentators are like, he said something that just hit me. And he said, one person does not make a championship team. And this is what I saw, because I watched the Golden State Warriors and they drive me crazy because they're good. So the reason they're saying one person doesn't make a championship team is because there's another player, multiple, that are running up and they are setting screens so Steph Curry can get a better shot. They are making this one thing that most people are like not even noticing, but there are multiple people that are stepping and they're throwing their bodies in the way so he can get a good shot so they can win. Does one person make a championship team? No. Do those screens matter? Heck yeah, they're driving me crazy because I'm like, I would hate to guard Steph Curry because everyone that guards him is like running into these big bodies all the time. The people setting the screen and they're trying to guard him and people are just bouncing off of these huge people. It matters. And that is what I feel like the Lord says. That screen matters. Every rebound matters. Feeding people matters. Praying for people matters. Caring for babies matters. Running a recovery center matters. And don't also, just because it's your thing, doesn't mean it's the thing God's calling everybody to do. We need to give people grace to be like, what is the thing that God is like? What is your part? What is your part? Like, and do your part. Because when people do their part, there's life on it. Like there's at least for me, this isn't like my whole part, but there's life here. I love this. I love digging in the Word. You know, other people would be like, I don't want to be up in front of people. Awesome. What does God put in your heart to do? You matter. It matters. And I just feel like kind of, you know, I'm going to wrap this up, but I feel like another thing that they did is they made room. They weren't like, you know, people are coming and it's getting really crowded, and I don't know if I really like these people that are coming to hear you, Elisha. You know, it's getting really crowded. And they weren't like, you know, we should just tell them to leave. They're like, we have a problem. People are coming. They're like, you know what? We have a solution. Let's carry a beam and let's make this bigger. And I just feel like everybody playing their part gives capacity to make it bigger. And not tripping up over somebody else's part also makes room.